What's up, Madison Covert, hey, Senior Global Executive at LinkedIn, joining us today. Thank you for your time, brother.
You got
Thank you for coming here and being with us today. Thank you for your time. Madison, give us a really quick 1-2-3 minute origin of who you are, where you came from, and how you ended up at LinkedIn.
That's great. Yeah, thanks, Brian. So I work on the global account team at LinkedIn with Elevate. It's an employee advocacy solution that we've just started to bring to market. So it's the opportunity to build a startup within a really large brand. But I've spent my career in startups. I was a early employee at 2U, which is an educational technology company, now $3 billion company on NASDAQ. I was there when there were about 100 employees. Made my way to Living Social during a period of pretty explosive growth in the daily deal space, and then ended up at Sprinklr, which is an enterprise social media management platform prior to LinkedIn. My experience, I've had the opportunity to work within high growth technology companies, disrupting ways that people communicate with each other and communicate with their customers.
Yep.
And you know, LinkedIn for me has been a really logical next step. It's the opportunity to help employees of really great brands build their own professional opportunities within those brands, but also help share the company message to their trusted first degree connections.
All right, so Madison, first of all, before we jump into the fun business side, let's jump into the fun baby side. Congratulations on your new child.
Thank you, I appreciate it.
Congratulations, Victoria, as well. Beautiful new thing in the world that you have. So yeah. Congrats, man.
Thank you.
So Madison, for those of you, I had a chance to visit with Madison before, so just to kind of digest what is Elevate, for those of you that are watching, Elevate is basically an ability for employees within bigger organizations and companies to create content that they are interested in to bring more awareness around what the company is promoting in terms of culture and content. Is that the best way to think about it?
Yeah.
What else could you add?
It's a great point, Brian. I'd say, you know, largely, you know, companies spend a lot of money and a lot of resources on creating great content.
Yep.
And they pay to distribute it through LinkedIn and a number of other channels. But the opportunity that we've realized is that the employee base reaches a really large, really unique audience. And in progressive brands like Unilever, Visa, et cetera, are actually instituting programs where they help employees subscribe to content that they're interested in and then make it really easy for them to share it to their personal network. In turn, we help those employees see, you know, what's happening as a result. So are they getting more connection requests, profile views? Is it influencing deals if they're a salesperson? So it's a really tremendous value proposition for both the employees and companies.
So I love the idea, Elevate. For those of you that are watching that are leading big companies that are in, you know, who would your client be for Elevate? What would the title be? What would the LinkedIn title be within the company that would buy Elevate?
It's a great question. I think one of the nice things that we have is the ability to work with multiple business units. So
okay.
A lot of times we're working with corporate communications. A lot of times we're working with talent. There are demonstrable success metrics across organizations. We influence a lot of hires. We help them get a lot more reach out of their marketing created content.
Yep.
We help salespeople perform better.
Yep.
And so we ultimately, in a consensus environment, often work with many different titles.
So I love that. So Elevate, for those of you that are watching on Facebook Live, for those of you that will be watching the YouTube show, anyone that wants Elevate, it seems like an incredible product. I personally don't use it, but it seems like an incredible product. If you're interested, get in touch with this young man. But I also want to talk about, for a lot of our listeners, 18 to 35 year old millennials, people that are entrepreneurs or people that have jobs that want to do more within that role. And I think what's really fascinating about what you're saying is something that we really believe in so much here, which is your personal brand is super important, whether you're an entrepreneur or an executive or yeah. working within a company.
Yep.
And so what you're probably seeing a lot with Elevate is the building out of that personal brand and all the rewards that come with it. So, you know, coming from a background of entrepreneurship yourself and in startup world, and seeing now some of the biggest brands in the world like Unilever and Visa and other clients that you can't mention, what do you think is the single best way for people, let's say the 1, 2, 3 biggest tips that you can give inside of a LinkedIn world if you're trying to build your personal brand?
Yeah. I think that's a great question. I think, you know, when we think about what LinkedIn does, ultimately our mission is to help create economic opportunity for
yep.
every member of the global workforce. There's 530 million connections on LinkedIn now, people on LinkedIn.
Wow.
So it's, you know, we're adding 2 members a second. Pretty cool statistic.
2 members a second?
Yeah.
That's cool.
And so when you think about that, ultimately there's this opportunity where you can connect to potentially 530 million other people. You know, mm-hmm. You know, when you think about professionally being connected and the opportunity opportunities to link with other alumni of schools, organizations that you've worked at. Yep. You know, the opportunity to create value for yourself and for others is tremendous. Yep. And so, you know, I think of LinkedIn as really a network where you can really curate your own professional brand, tell your story, what you do, what makes you great, value you bring to the roles that you want to support.
So let's say, I'm gonna dissect this a little bit because this is great information. Let's say I am new to LinkedIn, or I've been on LinkedIn for a while, but I've just kind of been there.
Sure.
What's the first way that I can optimize my profile to tell that story in a way that's compelling?
Yeah, I think that that's a great question. I think there's a summary section where you have the opportunity in free form text to really tell your story. A lot of people think of LinkedIn as an online resume, and I think you must look beyond that. It's the opportunity to really, you know, present your personal brand. When you start to do that, I think that's the first quick win that anybody can have. You
get into that summary.
Just create a great summary. Don't think of it as just bullet points of things you've done in previous jobs, but really the value that you've added.
How long should it be, the summary?
Yeah, I'd say a couple paragraphs maximum. You know, be succinct, but also, you know, be yourself.
And how businessy should that summary be?
I mean, I think it's very subjective. It should be really personal, in my opinion. It's the opportunity for you to say who you are, what you do, what you care about.
Yep.
Some of the best summaries I've read, you know, really don't talk much about the minutiae of people's roles.
Got it. So I built my summary. What do I do next if I want to build a personal brand inside of LinkedIn?
Yep. I think you need to connect with people that you that you've either worked with, that you went to school with. You know, you want to build out your network of trusted people, and the benefit here then is you start to also see a wider second and third degree network through all of your first degree connections.
So let me ask you a question. So let's just take what we're doing here as an example, right? Because I like practical examples. I have this thing called Brand in a Box.
Yep.
It's a one-day intensive here in New York City. People come in, I help them on their brand. We do a video for them. We do some headshots. We do some social media auditing. If that's the brand that I want to build inside of LinkedIn, what kind of connections would you advise me to look for?
Yeah, I think, you know, without knowing the ins and outs of your business, about being connected to people who have maybe employed you and endorsed you for this. You know, saying, hey, here's what we did with Brand in a Box. You know, here's some of the case studies that you stand up on LinkedIn. Because again, this is your professional hub. I think also it's the chance to connect to people you'd want to work with. See what their experience says in their summary or their profile so that when you reach out to them, your messaging is just that much more on point. But even if you don't reach out to them, you know, you figure out who they're, you know, the people you're going to ask to introduce you are. Mm-hmm. I think that's another one of the real strong powers of LinkedIn is, you know, you have the opportunity to see who you're connected to that's connected to somebody you want to be connected to.
Mm-hmm.
So again, when you build Brand in a Box, tell the story, show examples of value that you've created, and use the network as an opportunity to connect to the decision makers at companies that you want to do business with.
So that's cool. So a lot of people struggle with the ask of the decision maker. So let's say we know who the decision maker is. We also know that they probably get a lot of emails and they get a lot of requests.
Yep.
What is your advice for approaching the people cold? Let's say there's two situations, right? One is I have no connections in common with you, not even second or third, and I want to get in touch with you. And then the second one is, what would your strategic approach be to someone who, let's say, is a second connection?
Sure. The first scenario, I always think of the idea of why you and why you now. What value, you know, why am I reaching out to you today and why am I reaching out to you at all? Right? Because if there's no reason, right, if there's no reason at all, yeah, why you now? If you're just reaching out cold and you're pitching your message and you're not getting to know their business, you're adding no value and you don't deserve a response.
So give me an example of why you now and how that looks in a really great way.
Yeah, so think of, you know, let's look at Pepsi, for example. Pepsi had the Kendall Jenner crisis over the summer.
Yep.
You know, you might, if you're thinking about branding exercises and you're reaching out to a decision maker at Pepsi, it's, I'm reaching out because I saw there's a lot of negative pushback with relation to, you know, the Kendall Jenner commercials that you had. Around protesting.
Smart.
And I'm reaching out to you now because it's really relevant. Do you realize the impact that this is having, you know, across your brand?
And they'll probably say, yeah, of course I do. So what's the next thing that you write to them? Do you offer the solution in that message?
I mean, I think, look, you've got to keep it. The idea is not to sell through a message. It's to get a meeting, right? Once you get a meeting, you do your magic.
So you see it as a gateway to the personal.
Yeah, you're just trying to get somebody to give you some of their time. I mean, we're all very busy today.
Yes. Thank you for coming in.
Yeah, no problem at all. What you don't want is people just reaching out to you saying, I've got this product to push or I've got this idea, but there's no sort of relevancy to why you and why you now, and there's nothing that I know about your business, right? And so when people use the network really well, it's about adding value, you know, in the scenario where they may not have a first degree or secondary connection. To flip to your second question, when you do have a
really quick, before we go to the second question, Pepsi, great example. Yeah. You reach out, I see that they're getting a lot of bad press. I'm seeing that you're getting a lot of bad pushback. What is the line that you say next to get that 5-minute call?
Yeah, I mean, like, your call to action has to be unique and personal to you, but, you know, I would ask them outright, you know, how are you mitigating the risk to your brand that's being caused by a crisis like this?
And if I send 100 of those messages to 100 different relevant companies with relevant issues, how many people do you think I should expect to hear back?
I mean, again, it's, you know, everybody's data is going to be a little different, and I can't, you know, sort of go into sort of anything that would be too specific. But what I'd say from my experience is that, look, persistence also pays. A first message is not always going to, you know, generate a response, you know, so you've got to be persistent. It shows that you have multiple touch points through LinkedIn, you pick up the phone and call, you send emails, you try to find somebody who can introduce you. I mean, you have to socially sell. And this is where LinkedIn, again, as a network, has really pioneered this concept of social selling. It's helping professionals be professionally persistent in a way that's value.
Cool. And how would I add value? Is this enough value in this first email?
That's a good question. I mean, I think, look, you're giving them a reason for why them and why them now. The idea is there to get a conversation and to have a discovery conversation, right? Really understand what are the, you know, implications of something like this. You know, has this happened to you before? How have you handled it in the past? Who else is concerned about this problem? You know, if you're thinking of how to offer a consultative solution, it starts with really understanding the pain that they're having as a business.
Cool. That's helpful. Now, let's go to the second or third connected people.
Yep.
What do you do there?
I think, look, it depends on how well you're connected. So, you know, let's say that you're connected to somebody that I want to reach out to. I will ask. I'll send a direct message and say, hey, Brian, I realize that you're connected to such and such. You know, what's the context? Would you mind introducing me? Here's why I want to reach out. If I get a response, make it easy for them. Draft up what you want, what you want to ask for. You know, too many people just ask for an introduction with no context or without doing anything to help make that a simple process for, you know, whomever you're requesting that from. Really, really great people. Give context right off the bat. You know, thank people for their time, but also go ahead and tell them exactly what they want to ask for.
That's really helpful. Okay, and so that's step two.
Yep.
So step one is rock your summary. Step two is let's get these networks built up. Let's figure out who we want to talk to. Let's see how we're connected. Let's be thoughtful about the outreach. What's step three?
Yeah, I think, look, it's an ongoing process. I mean, you're never going to fully have something that's baked out, because with every network and every form of communication, you know, you've got to be at the touch points where your prospective customer or partner is, right? So I think we're part of a strategy, but you have to be on other social networks. You have to be in industry publications or at events. I mean, walk the halls, you know, do whatever you need to do to really get to know your customers and the challenges that you're trying to solve for them. Earn the right to do business.
I love that. And now, so that's sort of like the things that you know. We talked outside about how specific you can get inside of LinkedIn in terms of targeting people. Tell us a little bit more. Like, I guess, give us 3 or 4 or 5 amazing tips for using LinkedIn at the most optimized rate that a lot of people are not doing right now that they should be.
Yeah, I mean, again, totally dependent on the context, but you can really use it to map companies that you're interested in either working for, doing business for, understanding who decision makers in different departments are.
How do you do that?
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's a lot of courses I'd recommend. You can look at YouTube videos. LinkedIn has LinkedIn Learning, so there's, you know, lots of coursework I'd recommend here. It's a pretty in-depth process, but you really want to just, you know, understand how you can use the tool, not just to build your own professional brand, but also to research companies or people that you're interested in working with or doing business for.
So give us a few just practical ways of that people that are watching right now that say, I'm an entrepreneur, I want to get more business. Again, of course it varies, but what are a few of the tools that LinkedIn has for the everyday person that's not purchasing any upgrade or any service to use?
Yep. So, you know, you can look at a company's profile today, you know, and let's say you're looking at Visa.
Yep.
You can see how much the company has grown or declined in headcount over the last year.
How do you see that?
It just shows up under the company's profile page. So just searching for the company.
So you can start
to see who key executives are, other companies that are similar that people look at. We make all this available. So, you know, I'd suggest investing the time, you know, if you're researching particular companies, to really get to know their company page or their career page. All that information is publicly available.
Cool. What other kinds of things like that are available?
Yeah, I'd say, you know, what we really do is we try to specialize to different industry groups or topics. So, you know, we have programs like Sales Navigator, which are really helpful for people who are in a professional selling environment. You know, another thing you can do is LinkedIn publishes a lot of trending content. A product called Pulse that, you know, is now part of the LinkedIn newsfeed. It helps keep you up to date on current events. And one thing you can do is you can see who the thought leaders are in this space. Follow them, you know, get to know industry points of view. If you're interested in something, you know, let's say CPG, follow the thought leaders for CPG. If you're interested interested in, GE, follow people like Beth Comstock. All these people blog on LinkedIn. All these people share their point of view.
You know. So if you're interested in CPG, this is interesting, and you see some of the industry leaders talking, what else can you do around that ecosystem that's useful for you as someone that wants to build a brand?
Yeah, I mean, again, I think it's just continuing to see not only what they say, but what other thought leaders in the space say, what other companies in the space, how they're evolving. I think it's helpful to think of an industry in the sort of basket of companies analogy. You know, GE is only one of many companies that you might see in a certain segment. Really get a holistic perspective by following multiple companies, by following multiple CEOs or thought leaders, and by interacting and engaging. One of the best things we haven't talked about with the network is the ability to foster conversations within communities to join groups of like-minded people or of topics that you're interested in getting to know more about.
Cool. And then in terms of content creation yourself,
yep,
what are some of the best ways to become a content creator and a thought leader and an expert in a certain field as an individual?
I think I'd always recommend really being connected to a subject matter that you have expertise in or interest in, not going too broad. But
so let's say it's personal branding.
Yep.
And I'm just using myself as a guinea pig here, like personal branding for entrepreneurs that are just getting started.
Yep. Yep.
Where would you go?
From a LinkedIn perspective or more broadly?
From a LinkedIn perspective.
Yeah, I mean, you have the opportunity to publish directly on LinkedIn, and I recommend it because...
Just write articles.
Yep, write articles. You know, use the keywords that you think will be relevant, because people can search dynamically and they'll come back to things like personal branding, but also engage with your first degree connections. You know, tag them, ask them questions, get them building up a dialogue, and the dialogue will bring more people. I mean, ultimately...
How do you build up a dialogue with your first degree connections?
Yeah, so I mean, you've got Thomas Cook in the room, but with somebody here, you might at mention him to bring him into a conversation or to recognize him as a thought leader in a specific area. Thomas's first degree connections many times will also see that as well. Really start to involve other people from your own first degree network. And when you're talking about topics, link out to articles, blogs, other sort of research that'll ultimately drive people back to you.
And so something that you said interesting within the Elevate platform,
yep,
is that the more content employees share, the more their sort of connections see that they're active,
yep,
and that leads to more exposure to the company.
Yep.
Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
I think, if you look at employees' first degree connections, I'm connected to 3,000 people,
yep,
at a first degree level at LinkedIn, right? If you extrapolate me out over the other 11,000 employees that we have, we're connected to millions of unique first degree connections. People choose to be a first degree connection. It's not a requirement. You can unfollow people, you can unconnect with them or disconnect with them. But when people are first degree contact and they use our network, they will often see the content that I share and they'll engage with it. Right?
Yep. And let me ask you this question then. So do you think it's a smart strategy to engage other people to write about you there, on their LinkedIn profile, in their content that they create?
I think it depends on the perspective, and I also think...
Let's say I said, yep, Madison, you're doing all this brand building inside companies. Can me and you co-write an article?
Yep.
Is that something that's happening, and is that a smart move, or is that too intrusive?
I think it's close to the line of intrusive if that person is seen again as a subject matter expert or somebody who has the right to really talk about you as an authority. If they're a trusted recommender, then sure.
You would keep it at that trusted recommender level?
Yeah, unless you're collaborating on something that's like a mutual project. I think, especially for students, it's, yep, great to get your work out where you collaborate, because, yep, future employers might see that. Other people who might be interested in working with you on a project might see that, but you don't want to just relentlessly promote other people just sort of for the sake of doing it. I think that's a little inauthentic, and,
yep,
definitely something you're not doing, but something I would shy away from.
Right.
Only really, co-work on these sort of things if you think you're adding...
If there's a level, yeah, of trust and level of value added.
Exactly. And you see somebody as sort of a thought leader again in that space.
Madison, I want to move into video.
Yep.
What is video's role in LinkedIn? And I have a couple of questions about that. Mostly as a brand building tool.
Yep.
What is video's role? Also, what kind of trends are you seeing around people that are applying for jobs using video,
yep,
to get in the door?
I should also say, I'm not an official spokesperson for LinkedIn. I'm an employee.
No, of course.
My perspective that I see is largely that video is a new way to communicate. People are creating resumes on video.
And what are those resumes? What would you say is a good video resume?
We have people who are doing the whiteboard example of, going up and drawing on a whiteboard and then speeding it up and telling a story. I mean, that's a really
cool.
great example. example for people who are graphic designers, right? Yep. You have people who are
graphic designers.
Yeah, you have creative roles where, you know, you have people showcasing their talent or, you know, maybe their performance experience. I mean, I think video takes on a life of its own, and, you know, the world is very visual. The way we consume things via text is very different than through video or image. Video, again, just allows you to add a little bit more of a human touch to it. So.
And so what about as a brand building mechanism?
I mean, I think, look, you know, really well executed video really allows you the chance to visually depict your story. And consumers, especially if it's optimized for mobile, are much more likely to engage with something that brings them in versus has them, you know, sort of reading within the minutiae.
How do you optimize it for mobile?
I think, look, short, you got to keep things short. You got to keep things on point and relevant. You got to realize that, you know, much like we use Snapchat, Instagram these days, we don't have an attention span that is, you know, minutes or hours long. It is seconds, right? So be quick to the point, but draw people in. And then that could lead to more, you know, sort of longer pieces where you continue to build that person's connection to your brand.
What are some smart ways to use video as a brand building tool on LinkedIn?
I mean, again, tell your stories, you know, what research are you doing? What are your employees doing? You know, really humanize. You know, the way I see it most likely is from a brand perspective, because in my role, that's where I interact the most.
Yep.
You know, from an individual side, again, it's the chance to build your professional brand. So be careful, because, you know, video never goes away, right? The internet is undefeated, is the saying that I sort of think about. So, you know, be thoughtful about what you put up. It's your professional brand, and it's the professional brand to not only anyone who's connected to you, but anyone who's looking for somebody who has the skills that you have and comes across you.
Got it. So now, there's the content piece, which you've been brilliant to explain, and then there's the distribution, which is equally as important. You can create thousands and thousands of videos if no one sees them. You can write hundreds and hundreds of articles if no one reads them. What's the point? What are some distribution strategies and tools that we can use on LinkedIn?
I think from an individual level, again, it's also participating in groups that, you know, may relate to your topic of interest or industry. You'll start to get people who engage with you back and forth and really drive sort of the virality of the social network.
And how do you get involved with groups on LinkedIn?
Just search for them. I mean, there's a search bar at the top and on every page of LinkedIn. You know, if I'm interested in, you know, IT professionals, like, there are groups for that. If I'm interested in, you know, alumni of George Washington University, I can search that. Become a part of the conversation, but remain, you know, make it authentic. Again, don't just show up to
hire me.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like, really add, it really, you know, again, kind of cliche, I've said it a few times, but add value, right? Mm-hmm. Don't just be there to be there.
Okay, and then any other distribution tips besides the groups? Groups is great, tagging people is great.
Yeah, I mean, again, look, it's all about, you know, storytelling. So the more descriptive you are in a way that's relevant and captivating and interesting, use your summary, use blogs, tag people, use keywords that, you know, again, associate topics that you want to be seen leading a conversation about, and engage other people on the network. I mean, other than that, from an organic perspective, I think those are really the best practices that I personally have seen.
Is LinkedIn doing paid advertising?
Yes.
And what does that look like?
There's a lot. I'd encourage you sort of to look more deeply, but again, there's a lot of opportunities, you know, whether it's the sponsoring of content or things like reaching out with a sponsored in-mail, you know, again, that goes to the top of somebody's inbox. There are lots of different mechanisms there. In-mail is something we haven't talked about a lot, but it's the ability to send a targeted message that somebody gets and that they get prompted, you know, multiple times to review, you know, respond to, that unlike an email stays, you know, a lot more present. So that's another thing that we're doing, I think, can help people communicate with folks of interest.
Interesting. And so is hashtagging a thing in LinkedIn?
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that.
And if you write an article or if you make a post, you can add a hashtag, and, you know, we have search as well. So if somebody's searching for personal branding, a hashtag for personal branding is going to pull up the most relevant topics or mentions from the algorithm.
How many hashtags should I put on an article?
Say, look, you know, you don't want to see, you know, you don't want to have 50 or 100 hashtags. I think a couple of, you know, thoughtfully curated hashtags is okay. When it shows up with 10 or 15, people get fatigued from my experience because it just looks like something that people are trying to drive clicks to. Versus an authentic piece on personal branding.
Got it. Last question for you.
Sure.
Comparing all the social worlds, we do a lot of work with clients on Facebook, we do Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, and LinkedIn. Those are like the five that we really think everybody should be using. What do you think makes LinkedIn so different than the rest?
Every network offers the ability to reach a fairly unique audience, but also, you know, there are different actions you take on a Snapchat versus a Facebook versus a LinkedIn. I think LinkedIn ultimately is the hub for a professional brand. It's where every company is, and every company has a major presence. It's where you can connect to other potential employees at companies that you're interested in or that you want to do business with. And I think that element is very different. You know, ultimately is where the world goes to do business online and again, create economic opportunity.
Mm-hmm. And Madison, I know I said this last question, but actually I have more. That's cool.
All right.
You mentioned earlier about your case studies that you're allowed to talk about, sure. One being Unilever and the advantage of employees creating personal brands and what that's done for the company. Give us kind of a success story.
So using the Unilever example, they launched a formal employee advocacy program. In the first 12 months of running a program, they saw over 1,000 hires influenced by employee shared content. So what that means is when employees shared content, we saw the people engaged with it, and over a 12-month period, many of those people who engaged with it, over 1,000 of them became employees of Unilever themselves, changed their profile to work there.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, so again, people are influenced by others that they're connected to. Even during an interview process, they're often searching company news or they're reading what employees are saying. It's a really phenomenal proof point in terms of the power of the employee in helping a brand.
Cool. What's it like being a daddy?
It's awesome, dude. It's two full-time jobs at once, but wouldn't trade it for anything.
And I met your wife. What does she do? You guys are like power couple 101, power couple 505, power couple 999.
Yeah, it's
she's at YouTube, right?
Yeah, she has a social marketing agency called Anchor Media. She does work with YouTube and a number of other customers, but she does social media management and social media marketing. She works a lot in the influencer space as well. So we've both kind of grown up in social.
Cool.
Yeah.
It's like your kid is going to be a freaking genius.
Yeah, well, they're all what we call digital natives now, so.
Yeah. You know. Is your like, two-week-old child, like, already, like, navigating LinkedIn?
No, yeah,
is
no.
Did they have a profile yet?
Nope, no profiles. We're keeping her off the internet for now.
She's off the internet for now. Yeah, Madison, really appreciate you coming by, brother. Yep. There's a lot of great gems. Guys, LinkedIn, check this guy out. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for watching. Thank you for being here. Thank you for smiling. Thank you for connecting us, the master connector himself. Guys, remember, it's your life, it's your dream, it's your hour. Go get it, because if you don't, no one else will. Madison, thanks for popping by, brother.
My pleasure. Take care.
Peace.